I welcome the students of 4th year MBBS at Apsar Sahi Trust Hospital. Today is the lecture number 8. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today I will be delivering a lecture on multiple myeloma. First of all, as usual, our learning objectives are that after the end of the lecture, you will be able to define the multiple myeloma, you will be able to enumerate the clinical manifestations of multiple myeloma, and you will be capable of enlisting the complications of multiple myeloma, and you will be able to describe the different treatment options of multiple myeloma, and you will remember, I hope, the prognosis of multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma is a neoplastic proliferation of a single clone of plasma cells which produce monoclonal immunoglobulins. The spectrum ranges from Magus to plasma cell leukemia. The word Magus stands for monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance. And Magus and plasma cell leukemia, they are also fall in the differential diagnosis of the multiple myeloma. That is why the range of the multiple myeloma is from Magus to plasma cell leukemia, because they have similar features as the multiple myeloma. That is why there is sometimes a confusion in finalizing the diagnosis of the multiple myeloma. That is why the word range has been used from Magus to plasma cell leukemia. The etiology of the myeloma is unknown, but however, hypothetical implications which have been blamed are that it may be because of the genetic abnormality, or it may be because of the environmental factor, it may be because of occupational abnormalities, and it may be because of the agriculture, including agriculture and food and petrochemicals, insecticides, and finally the radiations which are offered by the of course the doctors, which are may be responsible for the causation of the multiple myeloma. So ranging from genetics to radiations are the hypotheses which so far have not been delineately labeled as the causes of the multiple myeloma, but these are the likely culprits in the genesis of the multiple myeloma. It is a 1% overall malignancy in the United States, but 10% of the hematological malignancies. Its incidence is about 4 to 5 cases per 100,000 patients. The median age at the presentation is usually 60 to 66 years, but rarely it may be found in patients below the 40 years of age, but the number is about 2%. In my experience, I have seen the cases, majority of the cases, patients were above the age of 70 to 80. In my practical life, I have seen a number of cases of multiple myeloma while working in Mayo Hospital, and when we used to visit the oncology department while preparing for fellowship, there are a lot many cases I have seen which used to present to the hospital with different clinical presentations, sometimes with paraplegia, sometimes with renal failure, sometimes with the patient used to present with the pancytopenia and fever, unexplained fever. Anyhow, it is a disease of the senior citizens, most of the cases. The clinical manifestations, first the symptoms, the Multiple myeloma is suspected usually due to widely varied symptoms, and which stay for more than 6% in 40% of the cases. The patient may present to you with the bony pains in majority of the cases, and sometimes with the pathological fracture, which means that without any trauma, spontaneous fractures, the patient will present to you with this pathological fractures or spontaneous fractures. I mean, no obvious cause, no trauma, but the patient lands to you with the complaint that this bone has broken, has got a fracture. So while you find it, you should be suspicious of that either the patient may be a case of vitamin D deficiency of osteomalacia, or the patient may be a case of multiple myeloma as well. And then in majority of the cases, other second number majority cases, they present to you with the weakness and fatigue, and then the weight loss and asthenia. Asthenia again stands for fatigue and weakness and malaise, etc. And less number of cases present with the dyspnea, and fever is found in rarely 1%, about 1% of the patients can present to you with the fever off and on. And sometimes the patient presents with the signs of the cord compression, which is usually the paraplegia, and the paraplegia is of the spastic type. And then the repeated infections, usually of the kidneys and of the lungs, they are the patient may present to you with the recurrent or intercurrent infections or repeated infections of the lungs or kidneys, I mean the recurrent pneumonias or recurrent pyelonephritis. If the patient presents to you, you should have a high suspicion of the multiple myeloma. These are the myeloma cells. Myeloma cells are unique. You see, they have been, the slide has been prepared by the bone marrow biopsy, bone marrow aspirate, and note that the patient is, that the patient is having blue cytoplasm, eccentric nucleus. You see, the nuclei are all these myeloma cells are cornered to a side of the cell, and there is a perinuclear halo or perinuclear pale zone. See all the cells from the top. This is a pale zone surrounding the nucleus. This is again a pale zone surrounding the nucleus. This is a pale zone surrounding the nucleus. This is again a pale zone or halo around the nucleus. So remember these features. If a slide is shown to you in the examination, say in the OSPI, you find such slide in which there is a large nucleus which is eccentric, the cytoplasm of the nucleus is blue, and there is a pale halo around the nucleus. This is a classical feature of the microscopic feature of the multiple myeloma. Now the clinical presentation, continuing, the patient may have pallor because of the bleeding or because of the poor intake, the anemia. The patient may have organomegaly, and the patient may have palpable lymph nodes. In the organomegaly, the patient may have hepatosplenomegaly. Then the patient can have radiculopathy because of the cord compression, and the patient can have similarly peripheral neuropathy, myopathy, and the tinel sign may be positive and phalen sign may be positive. Tinel sign, you see, you strike at the wrist joint, proximal part of the wrist joint, and there will be tingling and numbness sensation radiating to the fingers of the palm of the hand. Strike at the palmar aspect of the carpal tendon, and there will be tingling and numbness in the hands. And in the felon sign, you join the hands by the dorsal aspects of the joined hand, join the hands at the wrist level, and again the feelings will be described by the patient as to be tingling and numbness of the hands. So these two signs are highly suggestive of the multiple myeloma. Then sometimes the patient may present with signs of the renal failure, which may be patient may have nausea, vomiting, patient may have oliguria, patient may have edema, patient may have ascites, and the patient may have sometimes the pleural effusion. So signs of the, and the patient may have uremic froth also. So signs of the renal failure are found in patients who are senior citizens, especially when the patient is having age around 70 to 80 and the patient is non-hypertensive, you should either suspect that the patient may be a case of renal paralenchymal disease or the patient may be a case of multiple myeloma. Then the next sign may be HEAT examination, which stands for head, eyes, ear, nose and throat examination. The patient may have blurring of the vision, pupils may be normal or may be fixed, dilated, the patient may have jaundice and the patient may have parotiditis or parotid pain. Sometime in the absence of the diabetes, bilitis and hypertension, the patient, if you find on fundoscopy that there are retinal hemorrhages or cotton wool spots, again you should have a high suspicion that the patient might be a case of multiple myeloma. Continuing the signs, you see the color of the skin. If you find, you see the patient may have pallor because of the anemia, the patient may have ecchymosis or purpura, and the patient may have extramedullary plasma cytoma. The plasma cytomas may be found in the skin, may be in the GIT, may be in the prostate, and they may be found in the orbit. Plasma cytomas are actually tumors of the plasma cells, and they form discrete masses of cells in the skeleton or soft tissue. I repeat once again, plasma cytomas are tumors of the plasma cells, and they form discrete masses of cells in the skeleton or soft tissues. So remember, sometimes the only presentation of the patient is plasma cytomas, which may be a collection of the discrete plasma cells found in the bones or in the soft tissue. Then bony tenderness or pain without tenderness. See, at 360 degrees to each other. The patient may have bony tenderness only, or the patient may have only pain without any bony tenderness. And I described earlier that the patient may have organomegaly, which means that the patient may have hepatosplenomegaly. In the way you palpate the abdomen, you can find the hepatomegaly, and simultaneously you find splenomegaly as well. The myeloma is a disease in which the cardiomegaly can also be there, like amyloidosis. And it is also, amyloidosis is also a differential of the multiple myeloma. Now here in this picture, characteristic shoulder pad sign is shown. You see the shoulders of the patient have rounded pads, and the medial aspect of the chest is asthenic, emaciated, and the intercostal spaces and ribs are looking very prominent. And the same way, the sternocleidomastoid muscles and the supraclavicular fossae, they are emaciated, their soft tissue is lost. And compared to the shoulder pad sign, shoulder pads which are very prominent, looking like rounded balls of pads. right? So the shoulder pad sign, if you find this sign, you should always think of that the patient may be a case of multiple myeloma. On oral or buccal cavity examination, patient may have macroglossia, which means the tongue may be enlarged. And this enlargement of the tongue may be found in very various conditions, and one of them is amyloidosis. Then, when you do the proctoscopy of the patient, after the proctoscopy, the patient may have peripalpebral purpura, carpal tunnel syndrome, and the subcutaneous nodules. These are the other features, but after the proctoscopy, the patient may have peripalpebral purpura. Otherwise, normally if you do a proctoscopy of any individual, per se, to finding out the hemorrhoids or solitary rectal ulcer or anal fissure, etc., there will be no peripalpebral purpura, but in cases of multiple myeloma, you will be finding peripalpebral purpura if you perform the proctoscopy, right? Similarly, carpal tunnel syndrome, it can also be found in hypothyroidism, and sometimes over the whole of the body, sometimes the nodules of the plasma cells may be detected on the body or found on the body. Now the workup, you should do the CBC and with the differential count, and you should also perform the peripheral smear. ESR will be high and it will be greater than 100. The patient may have anemia, and it is usually the patient has pneumonia, anemia, and but sometimes the patient can present to you when you do the CBC, you will be finding the pancytopenia, or sometimes any two cell lines can be affected. So all the cell lines can be affected, one cell line, two cell line, or three cell lines, and there may be rollo formation. By rollo formation, I mean that there are stacks or aggregation of the RBCs. There are stacks or aggregations of the RBCs when you do the peripheral, when perform the peripheral smear. And the causes of the rollo formation may be infections, multiple myeloma, Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, cancer or any malignancy, and they may be found in the inflammatory conditions, and sometimes they are found in the connective tissue disorders. Then you go down to the check the history of the patient. If you check the serum calcium, it will be high. Creatinine may be high because of the renal dysfunction, because it is one of the important involvement of the kidneys, and by virtue of the involvement of the kidneys, the patient's RFTs may be deranged and the creatinine or urea will be high. The total proteins may be increased, uric acid may be high because of the increased cell turnover, and the CRP or C reactive protein will also be high. Then the very crucial tests which are diagnostic of the myeloma or multiple myeloma are SPECT or serum protein electrophoresis with immunofixation, and the sensitivity of the SPECT or serum protein electrophoresis is about 87%. Then you perform the UPEP or UPEP, 24-hour urine. This test is performed on 24-hour urine. Urinary protein electrophoresis. The word stands for UPEP stands for urinary protein electrophoresis. The sensitivity of this test is about 70%. Then you check the serum for light chains, and the light chain assay is performed. Lambda or kappa or lambda chains may be detectable on light chain assays. Continuing the investigations, you check the serum and urine for monoclonal proteins. I tell you that the in the multiple myeloma, different kinds of clonal proteins are found, and out of them one may be dominant. In myelomas, especially the IgG are most commonly found or most commonly raised. So that is why the serum and urine for monoclonal proteins test is performed, and the 24-hour urine for Wenz-Jones proteins is also a special test for the multiple myeloma, and which is actually the lambda light change. Then beta 2 microglobulins are checked in the multiple myeloma. Beta 2 microglobulins are checked. It is a protein which is encoded by the beta 2m gene. Listen again, that beta 2 microglobulin is a protein. It is encoded by the beta 2m gene, and it is used as a tumor marker for the blood cancer, and it has an association with the malignancies, and it evaluates the severity and prognosis of the myeloma, CLL, and non-Hodgkin lymphoma. Once again, I repeat for you that beta 2 microglobulin level, it evaluates the severity and prognosis of the multiple myeloma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, and non-Hodgkin lymphoma. Then the serum albumin level is also checked. The serum albumin level may be lower in cases of multiple myeloma. The reason for low albumin in cases of the myeloma will be that there are increased interleukin 6 levels in the circulation in cases of multiple myeloma, and this increased level of the interleukin 6 in the circulation, it blocks the production of albumin. So remember that in multiple myeloma, serum albumin level will be low, like you find the low albumin level in cases of CLDC, because of the many reasons, because of the poor intake, poor synthesis, etc. The patient serum albumin level is always low in cases of chronic liver disease. The same way, the serum albumin level will be low, but here the mechanism is different. The mechanism I have explained to you, that the high interleukin level 6 suppresses the formation of the, or blocks the formation of the albumin in the circulation. And similarly, you will check the LDH level, which may be high. Then you do the bone marrow biopsy, which is a diagnostic test. It is a gold standard for the bone marrow, because if you find the myeloma cells, the picture of which I have already shown to you, if you recall, the cytoplasm is blue in cases of myeloma cell, the nucleus is eccentric, and there is a pale zone or halo around the nucleus. So peculiar shaped plasma cells on bone marrow examination or bone marrow biopsy will be the gold standard test for the multiple myeloma. Then you do the cytogenetics for multiple myeloma. Cytogenetics, the word cytogenetics stands for that you find the changes in the chromosomes in cases of multiple myeloma. And these changes may be found that the chromosomes may be found sometimes broken, and sometimes some portions of the chromosomes may be missing, and sometimes the arranging pattern of the chromosome will be variable or different, or lastly, sometimes there may be an extra chromosome in cases of the multiple myeloma. Then FISH test or fluorescence in situ hybridization test is performed, and it maps out the genetic material, and it also detects the deletions and locations of a specific DNA sequence on chromosomes. So I once again repeat that the FISH in situ hybridization test, it detects the specific DNA sequence on chromosomes. Again listen, that it detects and locates the specific DNA sequence on the chromosomes. But the common word used for it is that it maps out the genetic material. Similarly, the deletions of the chromosomes can also be found in the cytogenetics and fish in situ hybridization test in Congo. Deletion on chromosome number 3 and deletion and exchange with the chromosome 4 into 14 and then 11 into 14 can happen also. Then you do the bone survey or skeletal survey and you will be finding the lytic lesions on the many bones, on the skull bones, on the humerus bones, or the hip bones, in the spines, etc. And then you perform the MRI of the spine and of the brain, etc. And MRI of the thorax can also be performed, MRI of the spine can also be performed. When you perform the MRI of the spine, you can find out the paraspinal plasma cytoma, and you can also detect the cord compression because of the paraspinal plasma cytoma. Then finally the PET scanning can also be very helpful in the finalization of the diagnosis of the multiple myeloma. Now you see the on X-rays, lytic lesions in the skull and the paraspinal plasma cytomas are found on the MRIs. And these are the this is the huge paraspinal plasma cytoma. This one black area or hyperintense area, low intense area. This black area is a paraspinal plasma cytoma. It can cause or produce spinal cord compression. Again, another view showing the plasma cytoma along the vertebra. The lytic lesions shown on X-rays in the say this is the humerus, lower end of the humerus. You can easily see the lytic lesions. Then bony lesions in the multiple myeloma. See here, one vertebra has a lytic lesion. Similarly, the lytic lesions can be found in the arms. Lytic lesions can be found in the head of the femur, and similarly in the lumbar spine, you can find the lumbar spine vertebrae. You can find the lytic lesions. You can see and remember that these are the important bony involvements in the multiple myeloma. Then bone marrow biopsy, earlier I mentioned to you the marrow plasmacytosis greater than 10% of the plasma cells are mandatory for the diagnosis of the multiple myeloma. Then you check the CD138 marker, also known as CINDICAN-1. It is a plasma cell marker. It is found in abnormal monoclonal plasma cells. I repeat once again, CD138 is also known as CINDICAN-1. It is a plasma cell marker. It is found in abnormal monoclones of plasma cells. Actually, it is a heparin sulfate proteoglycan that controls the tumor cell survival, the growth and adhesion of the cells and bone cell differentiation. I repeat once again, CD138 marker, it is a plasma cell marker, also known as CINDICAN-1. It is found in abnormal monoclonal plasma cell. Actually, it is composed of heparin sulfate proteoglycan that controls tumor cell survival, checks the growth of the plasma cells, adhesion of the plasma cells, and bone cell differentiation. Then focal bone involvement is also found in cases of the on bone marrow biopsy can be found. It requires 10 multiple biopsies. Coming to the diagnosis, the presence of serum and or urine monoclonal proteins. I told you earlier that the most commonly found immunoglobulin is IgG in cases of multiple myeloma. See, its percentage is about 53% of the IgA type, 25% IgD type, only 1%, and then free light chains are about 20%. Their percentage is about 20%, which are lambda and kappa chain. Then clonal plasma cells or plasma cytomas, I have already described to you the what are the plasma cytomas. They are enlisted in the diagnostic criteria of the multiple myeloma. Then end organ damage, the patient may have hypercalcemia, the patient may have renal failure, the patient may have anemia, and the patient may have lytic bony lesions, which I have shown to you in the earlier slides. The differential diagnosis. Now, these are the cases in which the M protein is elevated, contrary to the multiple myeloma, in which the IgG is predominantly raised. So, in what is the MAGUS? MAGUS is monoclonal gammopathy of unknown origin. And there are absence of symptoms, as in contrary to the multiple myeloma, the M protein usually raised, but it is less than 3 gram per liter, and the plasma cells are less than 10% in the marrow, contrary to the greater than 10% plasma cell in multiple myeloma. There will be no anemia, there will be no renal failure, there will be no hypercalcemia, and there won't be any lytic lesions on the skeletal survey. Then the smoldering multiple myeloma. The word smoldering stands for the non-active or asymptomatic multiple myeloma. So if somebody asks you what is the smoldering multiple myeloma, you should instantly respond that it is a myeloma which is non-active and which does not present with the symptoms. Because it does not produce the symptom, therefore the presentation will be asymptomatic. It meets the criteria for multiple myeloma, but no end organ damage. So the difference between the actual multiple myeloma and smoldering multiple myeloma is that it will be having all the criteria of the multiple myeloma, but there will be no end organ damage. Like classically, I showed you that the patient may have renal failure, the patient may have hypercalcemia, right? So then the differential is primary amyloidosis. You know, it is a disease of unknown etiology. It may be primary or secondary, and the patient can have macroglossia in it and hepatosplenomegaly as well. Then metastatic malignancies. Some features of the metastatic malignancies will be mimicking the multiple myeloma, because of the metastasis involvement of the bone marrow, they will be spread to the various organs, including liver, including spleen, including peritoneum, etc. So metastatic can also come into the contention of the multiple myeloma. Other lymphoid tissues are lymphomas, CLL and BSB and T cell lymphomas are also the differential diagnosis of the multiple myeloma. Then non-lymphoid neoplasm, breast CA, chronic myeloid leukemia, breast and colon cancer, cirrhosis of the liver and sarcoidosis are also the differential diagnosis of the multiple myeloma. Gaucher disease, the disease of the children, it is down the list in the differential diagnosis. Pyoderma gangrenosum, autoimmune conditions like myasthenia gravis, rheumatoid arthritis, and cold agglutinin disease, they are the weaker differentials or contenders of the multiple myeloma. Now, staging system, Dury's hormone staging, stage 1 to 3, 1AB, 1975, and includes that the patient should have high M protein, high calcium, radiographic bone involvement, hemoglobin low, and the patient should have renal failure. The international staging system is that the stage 1 to 3, it was forwarded, suggested in 2005, and in which the patient has high serum beta 2 microglobulin, and the patient will have low serum albumin. Now the treatment includes supportive therapy, treat the hypercalcemia, bone involvement with the usual therapies like analgesia, and the renal involvement with the adequate hydration and plasmapheresis. Plasmapheresis is the mainstay of the early start of the treatment of the multiple myeloma. Then the patient have, because low threshold for infectious complications, so you will have to offer the antibiotics for the infections again and again. The patient may have hyperviscosity, for which you will be requiring plasmapheresis again. Then neurological compromise, the palliational radiation is performed, and for anemia you can do the red cell transfusion. If the patient is suffering from pancytopenia, you can transfuse the whole blood. If the single cell is affected, you can offer the red packed cell transfusions. Then turmeric, curcumin, which is an antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, but what causes magus or monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance. Turmeric actually is healthy, if you remember, right? So turmeric is very helpful in cases of multiple myeloma and other tumor lysis syndromes, but it causes monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance. Initiation of specific therapy. Chemotherapy is performed with the drugs thalidomide, dexamethasone, melphalan, and prednisone combination. Bortezomib, and which is actually proteasome inhibitor, lenalidomide plus dexamethasone combination, then bortezomib plus melphalan. So some combinations are of more benefits: melphalan, prednisolone, bortezomib, melphalan, lenalidomide, dexamethasone. These combinations plus again a combination regime, WAD regime, which comprises of vincristine, adriamycin, and dexamethasone, also has greater weightage in the treatment modality of the multiple myeloma or therapy of the multiple myeloma. Finally, the HSCT, which stands for the hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, it is the last resort as a therapy for the multiple myeloma when all other above therapeutic options have failed. Then you have to go for the hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. Prognosis: the disease is usually fatal. 10 to 20% of the mortality within first 2 months. The mean survival is 4 to 5 years. 5-year survival rate is about 30%, and 10-year survival rate is about 10%, and 15-year survival is only 4%. So majority of the patients, they die within 4 to 5 years. And it is dependent upon the tumor burden, and the tumor burden is assessed by the high CRPs, the levels of the beta 2 microglobulin, which predict the survival of the patient along with the tumor burden. The survival can be improved with the therapy including the hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. Lambda light chain disease, 3 times worse and prognosis than kappa light chain disease. So remember that the lambda light chain disease is worse than the kappa light chain disease. and the major cause of death is the progressive myeloma, renal failure and sepsis. So remember these three causes of death, that the patient dies of sepsis, recurrent infections, renal failure and progression of the multiple myeloma. Then therapy related acute leukemia or myelodysplasia can also accrue to the patient, and 25% of the patients, they die of the age related illness and increased tumor mass and the increased calcium level and Bench-Jones proteins. So keep on monitoring while you are treating the patients of multiple myeloma, because they can transform into the acute leukemias and they can transform into the myelodysplasia. So simultaneously you should check the serum calcium levels repeatedly and Bench-Jones proteins repeatedly, not only for the diagnostic purpose but also for the monitoring of the prognosis of the multiple myeloma. Now finally, the assignment is being dispatched to you. There are three SCQs. Kindly solve them in the at least 1 hour, and you people have been sending the assignments very late, which is very painful, and some people have been marked absent last time because they sent the solved assignments in the evening, say in the night. So this is very objectionable, and the college does not allow, because our college authorities are monitoring your response to the lectures, your assignments, and we also intimate the college authorities that the students are not sending the assignments in time. That is why these students are being marked absent. So kindly, I request you all, because you are my dear students, therefore I make a humble request to all of you that please do solve the assignment in time. So this is SEQ number 2 and then the SEQ number 3. Any question you can ask me in addition to sending the solved assignments. I pay thanks to all of you for joining me at Aftar Sahib Trust Hospital. I hope you might have enjoyed this lecture, because this is very important, and I have tried to make it interesting for you. And finally, I say goodbye everybody from Aftar Sahib Trust Hospital, 4th year MBBS class.